This is a humble jellyfish, a slimy floaty blob of not much. But this ocean-going Jello can teach us a lot about how money works, and since that's
why I'm here,
let me explain. You see, zoos and aquariums around the world display all sorts of fancy creatures for a whole bunch of reasons. They offer scientists a controlled environment to study animals, breeding programs for species on the edge of extinction, and of course, they offer a fun day for people who just want to look at animals. That last part is especially important for these zoos because even the ones that are not run for profit need those visitor dollars to pay for the first two functions. Now, the best way to achieve all of these three things is to have a diverse selection of animals. Back in the day, this was pretty easy. Zoos became popular in the 19th century as royal menageries, or exotic animal shelters, were made available to the public for a modest admission. This is why a lot of zoos around Europe are still called royal zoos to this day. The success of these early establishments led to for-profit zoos springing up all over Europe and America to get a slice of this profitable little pastime. Kitting out the zoo with animals was merely a matter of finding an exotic animal dealer and placing an order. The animals were just a business asset to bring in money, no different from the gift shop or the land the zoo was on. Unfortunately for our would-be zookeepers, America passed the Endangered Species and Wildlife Act in 1973, which expressly forbid the sale or trade of wild animals for money. Around this same time period, most other countries followed suit with similar laws. This means that zoos looking to fill out their enclosures could no longer just pay to win. Of course, for existing zoos, this wasn't a major issue. Animals are great because they have an inbuilt copy and paste function. But this law did massively slow down the opening of any new parks, especially those that were to be run for profit. Even still, the existing parks did need to set up a system of trade to ensure that they got a fair chance at achieving these three main goals. So, they had to figure out a system of exchange that didn't involve money. Now, there were two different approaches taken to this. Regular zoos from around the world established the most simple form of exchanging goods and services, the don't be a dick approach. Basically, zoos will openly trade their animals for nothing but good karma amongst other zoos to ensure that healthy populations are maintained, research can be conducted, breeding programs are facilitated, and of course, tickets sold. This is the medium of exchange that served early humanity before more sophisticated systems took hold. It's a common misconception that bartering, as in trading one goat for 10 bales of corn, was the standard before currencies came along. And in reality, there is actually no historic evidence of bartering being used as a widespread medium of exchange in any culture at any point in history. Before currencies, people simply tended to exist in small communal groups that simply shared stuff equitably amongst themselves, just the same as you would with your friends and family, which was entirely what these early groups were made up of. Of course, as soon as these groups got large enough that not everybody knew everybody else, like say early cities, this honor system quickly broke down. That is why, in many ways, the adoption of currencies is just as vital to human development as agriculture, the wheel, and domesticated animals. Now, speaking of domesticated animals, you might be asking, this is great, but what does this have to do with jellyfish economics? Well, you see, while the zoos were content to adopt this very easy breezy system of good karma, their aquatic counterparts, the aquariums, decided to take a more capitalistic approach. Now, they couldn't trade the animals for money or anything else of value, because, of course, that would break the various laws around the world and encourage people to hunt live animals for profit. So, instead, they traded animals for animals. Now, you might say, well, isn't that just bartering? And you would be right, but there is one key difference. Aquariums have a reserve currency, the jellyfish. The jellyfish surprisingly makes a good currency for a few good reasons. For starters, their individual value is pretty low. They are pretty much the least valuable thing on display in most aquariums, which is good because you can't divide marine life into pennies and dimes like you can a dollar, because, well, that kills the fish. So, jellyfish work well because anything else on display is going to be some multiple of a jellyfish. They are also relatively easy and cheap to keep, and their populations remain stable year-round, which means that you don't have to worry about hyperinflation caused by reckless jellyfish printing. In many ways, these are all the same reasons that gold was such a popular medium of exchange around the world before modern fiat currencies rose to prominence in the mid-20th century. Now, interestingly enough, just because jellyfish have these traits does not mean they are totally immune from inflation. and seasonal spikes have seen the value of these slimy poker chips decline. But overall, it gets the job done, which is really the big takeaway here. Now, I'm sure you want to know the exchange rate between a jellyfish and the US dollar currency pair. And surprisingly enough, if we use the secondary exchange rate between a jellyfish and a fish you can buy to eat, we will find that this currency pair is almost at parity. But don't think that you can get rich scooping these little creatures out of the water. Some of them will sting you, and their value depends a lot on you individually being a reliable trading partner for marine animals other than just jellyfish. Even if you did manage to pull it off, all you would be able to trade it for is a penguin or something, which is cool, but you know, kind of hard to look after. In reality, most trades between aquariums will be a direct swap of one animal for another, but being able to throw in a few extra jellyfish on the side smooths out the transaction enough to ensure that these venues can continue to trade efficiently and complete their core responsibilities. Fortunately, for now at least, people haven't started speculating on the jellyfish market, but if you happen to dive into this market and end up making a lot of money in the process, be sure to follow our step-by-step guide on how not to lose your newfound fortune, because, you know, that would sting. And while you're at it, make sure to like, comment, and subscribe to keep on learning how money works.